And before we get started, I'll just let you know, we will stop at 10 o'clock tonight, okay? The board doesn't hear any cases past 10 o'clock. We have four cases in front of us, and we could get into that later hour. So we'll make a decision then to continue the cases that are left to a future date, okay? There are sign-in sheets outside the door if you're speaking this evening. Also, there's one for people attending tonight in case further information needs to be sent to you regarding any of our cases. Before we get started, we'll start with the introduction of our board. To my left,
Stuart Egli, alternate.
Wayne Medensky.
John Brown.
George Allen Hayden.
Ashley Renshaw, recording secretary.
Ronald Payne.
William Green.
George Sparling, county attorney.
Yvonne Chalet, zoning administrator.
Thank you. My first hearing tonight is a case that was continued from 9/18/16. Is a variance request, VAAP 14-132-009, Morelli Auto Group. Anyone representing those folks tonight? So just to bring everybody up to speed, and I'll ask for some help here at the board if I miss anything. We opened the hearing up. We went through the county's report on it, and we went through the presentation from the Morelli Group. Okay, and the board wanted to see a planning agreement plan presented before we would either approve or deny the request for the applicant. Okay, so I think that's where we are this evening, is to look at the presentation of the planting agreements. Okay.
Okay.
So
yes.
Before we get going, is whoever's going to be giving testimony will swear you in. Okay. And we'll do it one at a time. Okay. Wait, all three of you speaking?
It depends on how it goes.
Okay.
Mr.
Then
Chairman.
We'll do them one at a time. Yeah. Okay. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And if you would, for the record, your name?
Yes, Mr. Chair, good evening. Steve Scott on behalf of the applicant. Also, Phil Morelli, the owner, is with us. And Dan Kelch from Collison Olaf and Associates in Prince Frederick. And as the chair points out, yes, this is a continuation from the hearing that started in the last session of the Board of Appeals. And we hope to present the requested information and answer any further questions and conclude this hearing this evening. So I'll turn it over to Dan to explain the additional information he's provided.
Okay.
Based on the
that's what he took to. He also took it. Go ahead.
Based on the discussion that we had at the last meeting, I contacted Live Green Landscapers and asked that they review the plan. I explained to them the concerns that the Board of Appeals had, forwarded them the planning requirements contained in the zoning ordinance, and just asked them to do the best job of balancing the concerns of the Board of Appeals as well as the safety of cars coming in and out of the property.
Right. Mr. Kelch, did you do a PowerPoint on that or not?
Last time?
No, now, for tonight.
I did not.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, I was going to drop the boards in case you needed them.
No.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay, sorry, go ahead.
I thought I was done.
Okay. So what you have here in front of us, just so I understand, you've submitted the drawing again tonight, C20. And if I read this correctly, you have a 30-foot buffer on the north side facing 235. Comes across, and then it looks like you have more parking spots on that front. You have 8'4" buffer. Am I reading it right?
That's correct. It's the same plan. I just enlarged it because I think there was trouble reading the plan from last time.
Okay.
Could you explain this a little better for me?
Sure. Basically, what the landscaper provided was a combination of low-growing plants to for decorative purposes.
Those are the smaller circles. What are those?
That's correct.
Which plants are those?
I would have to look at the legend down in the lower right corner.
Those are shrubs, Mr. Vanesky.
Those are shrubs?
Yes.
And then the, what are the next ones?
Next ones are, yeah.
The middles.
Right. The next ones are a taller evergreen type shrubbery, and then there's trees.
How tall did they get?
Generally speaking, they're 3 to 5 foot. Growth. Then there's trees interspersed. And what you can see, obviously off the property, but within the right-of-way, is the existing tree line that goes down Route 235.
Right.
So there's part of the nuance of the plan was that the landscaper understands how many plants can take up a certain area and still have the root systems that will thrive and whatnot. So he had to balance what was already there and ought to remain. And then the smaller area that we had with the front parking spaces, as well as the site distance looking to the left as you're headed out of the property so that you didn't get sideswiped. There's also the two bioretention devices on either side of the entrance. And so he also specified those plants in order to create a decorative screening facility there, but again, he couldn't push it too far especially along the left side because of the site distance.
And what did he specify for the rain gardens? I don't see that.
They're all in that same legend. Should be.
Yeah.
So I appreciate your calling that out. The the rectangles with numbered boxes correspond to the depths within the stormwater management, the bioretention areas, and so a bioretention area expects to have different ponding levels. And so as you see in the center, that number one is the 150, I don't speak Latin, so Juncus effusus are more a low-growing plant, but can get a little bit higher. The iris versicolor are to provide some color and variety. And then he's placed the trees off to the back corner, as well as to the right, the left property corner. And again, that's where it started to conflict with some of the street trees.
Right. Those in the rain gardens are all plugs.
What's that?
All plugs. Okay. That's why it's so many of them. Okay.
Correct.
What it is, it's a small plug like that, right. that's just seated in.
Right.
And it all depends on how much water gets in and how much of them will live.
Right.
Okay. So.
Yeah, I'm used to seeing those.
Right. Okay. Any questions?
No, I'm good. This is what I wanted. I wanted to see what this was, and we have something to show what's supposed to be there. Before, it was just so general, you couldn't tell what was going on. I'm perfectly fine with this.
Okay.
I'm good.
I'm good. Any other questions? We went through the whole process last time. We went through the public hearings. I mean, public testimony, so I'm not going to open that, reopen that back up again. Because the only thing the board wanted to see was the planting. So with no other questions, any other comments?
One question. To the right of your diagram, at the last meeting, you mentioned about the property to the right of your property, whereby a car, vehicles can easily access one property to the other, So now, you don't really show that here. I mean, I assume that I'm looking at the correct place, but I mean, you don't really show an opening where you are, vehicles can easily access one property to the other.
That's correct. The intent, similar to what's on the other side, directly across, is to bring that pavement to the property line as far as we can do so without requiring a grading permit from the neighboring property.
Say it again.
The intent is to carry where you see the curved area, which is what's preventing you from getting to the property line. This is the plan that was presented to the Planning Commission at the time and got approval, so I did not make any of the changes, but one of the changes that would be made as part of the site plan process, the next submittal, would be to square that off so that it we bring the pavement as far and as close to the property line as we can so that the other property owner can pick up from there, as well as provide an easement so any construction that they need in order to connect the two, that they'll have the rights to do it and the ability to do it without having to ask for any special permission. Did that make sense?
So at this time, you don't know whether or not the adjacent properties, because you said that they would have to make some adjustments. The adjacent properties would have to make an adjustment. So in order to easily access your property, if I understand you correctly.
The parking along the property on the right-hand side has a parking arrangement similar to what we're proposing here.
Okay. When you say right side, is it, I'm looking at, you mean the right side towards Route 235, is that correct? Oh, that's?
Yes.
Okay.
So we're lining up that aisle, again, very, the same as what's being done on the left side with the hotel owner, so that okay. Those two can be connected, and our intent is to do the same on the right-hand side, and we will certainly talk with that property owner and encourage that. Sometimes people don't want to pursue that at a certain time, but they want to know that they have the ability to do so. And
so are you saying that this time you don't know if they are going to agree to that or not?
I do not know that, no. Well, let me say,
I mean, this was the whole basis of your requesting that the buffer is changed, that so you could have a access to parties to the right and the left, but you don't know if they will agree to that or not.
Yeah, I think what Mr. Kelch is saying is we want to facilitate interparcel connectors. Obviously, that's good and appropriate planning process. There is an existing easement. I've reviewed the titles to these properties. There's an existing easement between this parcel and this one's a hotel?
This one's a hotel.
Okay, so there's an existing easement between us and the one on the left. Mm-hmm. So that interparcel connector can be facilitated.
Okay.
The one on the right, we want to get to the point where we can easily connect the parcels, and obviously we're going to approach the landowner and try to facilitate that. I think also in addition to the interparcel connectors, which makes sense, excuse me, because the main road is such a busy highway, and we certainly want to facilitate those. We also want to put this property on par with some of the other developed parcels in the area. And I think in that respect, the request for the variance is twofold. Also, we think that the request for the variance is something that makes us compatible with the surrounding properties and with the surrounding developed parcels, and certainly with the parcel to the, if you're looking at the plan to the left. So I think it puts in place that planning process to interparcel connect these that we all hope will happen.
Okay.
But there is an existing easement with one of them.
All right.
Does that answer the question? Okay.
Good. Good. Anyone else have any questions? Then I'm open for a motion.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
In the matter of VAAP number 14-132-009, having made a finding that the standards for granting a variance and the objective of section 63.3B of the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance have been met, what, based on this drawing, really? What's the name of the drawing?
It's a C2 dot...
Drawing C2.0. Okay. I move to approve the variance request to reduce the required 65-foot buffer to a viable width buffer or ranging from 8 feet to 27 feet along the property's frontage with Maryland Route 235. Again, based on this drawing of C2.0.
One second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions? Start with Mr. Green. Yes?
Yes.
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 Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. An order reflecting the board's decision will be signed, will be prepared by staff and signed by the board within 30 days. Okay. The 30-day period follows from the date that the order is signed, during which any aggrieved party may appeal this board's decision to the circuit court. Any action taken during that time will be at your own risk. And we'll send you a copy of the order once it's signed.
Appreciate it very much. Okay. Thank you.
Chairman.
And we have the order here tonight.
You're going to sign it tonight, correct? Tonight. That was what was decided last time.
Okay. So we'll sign that. We'll get your copy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Jim.
You may want to vote on approving the order, but before Mr. Scott leaves, I think, if I recall, the order talks about in accordance with the landscape plan attached. I may be wrong. It would probably be at the very end of the order.
It's a variable, to a variable width buffer. Okay.
Right.
Good. Okay. We're good.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks again. Have a good evening. She's got one.
Okay.
She's got one. Our next case this evening is also a continued case from August 11th of 2016. It's a variance request, VAAP 15-0690, the Hammett property. Do you have your staff report tonight for this?
We already did that.
Okay.
The last hearing staff presented its report. The applicants started their presentation if I remember correctly, and the board asked that they show the topography on there.
Okay.
That's what I thought happened.
We'll check it really quick. We're going to take a 5-minute recess.
Okay.
Okay, we'll be back in 5 minutes. All right, we're back. Looks like where we left off was the because of the critical area response to the first drawings that we had that didn't include the topo, and they wouldn't give a response on that with the soils and stuff. So that's where we left it at. And so if we would, we'll go ahead and get you sworn in, Ms. Chalet, and we'll start off with your
Okay.
Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you.
The applicant's request of variance from section 71.8.3 of the comprehensive zoning ordinance to disturb the critical area buffer to construct an addition. Property owners are Donald and Jean Hammett. The property is located at 48721 Whitaker Road in St. Inigo's on tax map 67, grid 17, parcel 316. This is lot 500-10, the St. Inigo's Landing subdivision. It's in the first election district, and the property is 6.12 acres in size. It is zoned rural preservation district with a resource conservation area, critical area overlay. The property and the variance request were advertised in the Enterprise on July 27th and August 13th, 2016. This case was continued from August 11th. The property is a grandfather lot in the critical area of St. Mary's County because it was recorded in 1981 prior to adoption of the critical area regulations in December 1985. Lot 10 was originally recorded in 1978 as Section 1 of St. Inigo's Landing. Property is essentially constrained in its entirety by the critical area buffer as measured from the edge of the mean high water line of a tributary stream which drains into Jutland Creek to the south and west of the property. This buffer is expanded for tidal wetlands, steep slopes, highly erodible soils, and hydric soils. Soils types found on the property are tidal marsh, croom gravelly silt loam, and sassafras chillum complex. The TM soils are the hydric soils and commonly support only marsh grasses and sedges and a few other salt-tolerant herbs and small shrubs. TM soils are suitable for use as habitat for wetland wildlife. The CRD3 soils are highly erodible soils found on 10 to 15% slopes. They are best suited for wetlands. The SMC2 soils are found on 6 to 12% slopes. Although not considered highly erodible, a moderate amount of surface soil has eroded and the hazard of further erosion is moderate to severe. The southern part of the property is within special flood hazard areas AE4 and AE5 according to flood insurance rate map panel 344F. Zone AE is defined in the county's floodplain management regulations as special flood hazard areas subject to inundation by the 1% annual chance or 100-year flood. Base flood elevations are determined. Floodways may or may not be determined. All development that's proposed with this request is outside the special flood hazard areas. The property contains a two-story single-family dwelling and basement with an attached deck, a detached building containing a shop, a detached building containing a studio, and a detached shed for a total of 3,460 square feet of lot coverage. The two existing driveways equal 7,548 square feet of lot coverage for a sum of 11,010 square feet of lot coverage. If the deck has space between the deck boards to allow water to flow through freely, then the deck would not count as lot coverage. Assuming that this is true, the existing amount of lot coverage equals 10,620 square feet. The applicants propose to construct an addition on the east side of the house for another 1,185 square feet of lot coverage. The applicants also plan to build a third driveway which will extend from one of the existing driveways off Whitaker Road to the addition. This new driveway will create another 1,845 square feet of lot coverage for a total of 9,393 square feet of lot coverage in driveway alone. The amount of lot coverage on the property following construction will be 13,650 square feet or 5 1/12% of the property. This amount does not include the 390 square foot deck. A private well and septic system serve the property. Approximately 82% of the property is covered in vegetation, according to the aerial accompanying this report. The applicant plans to clear 2.25% of the existing vegetation. Health Department approved the site plan on May 16th, and the Soil Conservation District approved the site plan on February 10th, 2016. Critical Area Commission comments were received, and that is the reason why the board continued the hearing, because the commission had wanted to see topo. Staff also noted some information from a prior critical area case that went before the Maryland Court of Special Appeals, and that was North versus St. Mary's County, and that was a situation where the judge determined that uniqueness is an aspect of a variance request that needs to be found regarding unwarranted hardship, and that the board needs to determine that an unwarranted hardship exists in order to grant the variance. And that's staff's report.
Can I ask a question, Mr. Chairman? The original critical areas letter indicated that they would provide additional comments.
We did not get additional comments from them.
Did the Critical Area Commission have an opportunity to review the updated site plan?
I believe they did, yes.
Thank you. Just to make sure the record was clear.
I don't see anything in front of me. Just the first submission. And the, I'll come to that in a bit, but. Thank you, Michelle. You want to submit that as your exhibit?
Oh, yes, I would like to submit the staff report and attachments as staff exhibit 2.
Thank you. Any questions from the board for Michelle?
I got one question. We do have a record of having submitted this updated site plan, right? Okay.
Yes.
To the Critical Area Commission.
Yes.
All right. Mr. Hammond?
Yes, sir.
Again, for the record, if you would tell us who you are and where you live.
Okay. Yeah, I'm Donald Hammond. Live at 48721 Whitaker Road, St. Inigo's, Maryland.
And before you get started here, do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Is Mrs. Hammond giving testimony tonight?
She might very well.
Okay, then I'd like to swear you in too, please. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the truth and nothing but the truth? And for the record, if you would give us your name and address as well.
My name is Jean Hammett, and I also live at 48721 Whitaker Road, St. Inigo's, Maryland.
Okay. Right there.
Yes, sir. You suggested that we prepare a PowerPoint presentation. We did not be confident in our IT department. She's the IT department.
Mr. Hammond, you need to speak into the microphone, or what you're saying will get picked up.
Thank you. And do you need the boards to come down, ma'am?
There is no sound to the.
No, I'm not worried about sound. That way everyone can see what you're doing.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. How do I get it to show up there?
Hey, we may need some help out here.
It'll load. Give it a second.
Oh, come on.
Oh, okay.
Okay. That's good. Mr. Hunt's our tech guy tonight. And for the record, Mr. Hunt, Deputy Director of Land Use and Growth Management, is sitting in the audience now, too. Good evening. Okay. Mr. Hammond?
Okay. We've prepared a presentation. Last time I did it, it took about 18 minutes, and we did it with the idea of alleviating your concerns and addressing all the questions in the county staff report and Claudia Jones' report. And at first, I'd like to thank the members for their service and dedication. As someone who has served on three county commissioner advisory boards myself, I can appreciate your dedication and the time invested. Our variance is needed because our entire house is situated in the critical area buffers extended. The proposed addition has to be in the critical area because the existing development is actually an island in that critical area buffer, and we have no option to add to our ground floor without being in the buffer. The existing home does not meet our age in place needs. As sure as we're going to continue to age, eventually our use will be denied by the our three-story home. And there's no option to squeeze a bedroom and bathroom, which are lacking on the ground floor, into the existing first floor plan because of basic 32 foot by 32 foot small footprint home that we designed back in the 1980s in our youth when we had no idea at some point three stories would be an obstacle. Phase one of permit 10931, which we recently finished, we constructed main floor entrance to the north side of the house on the only on-grade side of the house. It was designed utilizing the existing lot topography. And access to that, we utilized an existing 1980s service corridor that we had installed initially. We thought that was actually going to be the main access to the house, but as things go, we ended up driving into the basement. And that service corridor did, we used to set the septic tank and boom trucks and that sort of deliver drywall and take it through the windows, that sort of thing. Phase two, the 519 square foot ensuite addition and garage. Now the garage isn't included in that 519 square foot. It's one car garage with ample room to walk around it. It is the minimum we need to age in place. We located on the only on-grade side of the home, and the total living space on the age-in-place floor when we finish this addition will be, not including the garage, will be 1,613 square foot. Not a large home by today's standards. The bridge connecting the original house to the addition, we did this to minimize the impact, and that bridge isn't even in contact with the ground. It rests on the original house on one side and on the addition on the other, and is included in that 519 square feet. Mother Nature provided us the building site. We've accepted the perils of forest living to the benefit of the critical area, and we've done this to save the bay. The garages are needed for us to age in place and will provide us the safety for our possessions as well as ourselves as we come and go in inclement weather. We feel that the grandfathered unwarranted hardship standard would apply. Our home is an island in the buffer and does not support age in place. Addressing A through F and special conditions and circumstances, in 1980, we built the greenest home that we could build and afford. To do this, we actually purchased two lots in the 80s. Back in the 80s, we're all old enough to remember the discussion, how large should lots be, and there was discussion of 2 acres, 3 acres, 4 acres, 6 acres. They settled on 3 acres. The subdivision was subdivided into about 3.5 acre lots. We incurred the additional expense to buy two lots and then also incurred the additional expense of combining the two lots. That's why you saw the two subdivision entries there and had them combined to form one large 6-plus acre lot. And the lot is totally covered by trees, and when we lose a tree, I actually go out and plant 3 more trees. I love the trees. We love the trees. Hazardous trees. Forest living routinely presents special circumstances. Wednesday's Enterprise, below the fold. We had a death in the county caused by a hazardous tree. Circumstances associated with forest living, we shoulder the expense and worry, but we do it willingly for the bay. Special circumstances of forest living, it's not if, but when and how much damage will be incurred by falling trees and branches. This will come to bear when we talk about driveways and parking spaces. Tree replacement, I'm constantly replanting trees. The critical areas expanded for things like erodible soils and steep slopes, but we've lived our life mitigating this. We've chosen to live with small lawn area around the house, minimizing noise pollution, sound pollution, chemicals on the lawn, fertilizer, nitrogen introduction into the waterways. Erosion control measures. I've been ahead of the curve installing rain gardens, sediment areas, nitrogen trenches, all to mitigate our impact on our environment. The condition of three-story living is a barrier to growing old in our house. As primary caregivers, my wife and myself, of my now deceased parents, we know the importance of appropriate facilities. As top runners with Company 49 of the Ridge Rescue Squad, we deal with hundreds of inappropriate facilities every year. And I would say our three-story home, if the Company 49 had to get me out, they'd have to call for manpower, not only Company 4, but they'd have to get messy because they'd have to bring me down three flights of stairs, and each of those have a landing involved, tight turns, just not suitable for age and place. Section B, strict interpretation will deny us use. We're the only ones on Whitaker Road without single-level living access. There's only one other neighbor who does not have at least three bedrooms. We designed a two-bedroom home, and that's going to affect our saleability. When it comes time to go into assisted living, we'll have the hardship of having to sell a two-bedroom home. Difficult task. Special conditions of this lot topography and location of the house in that topography warrants considerations. We're the only ones in our subdivision dealing with topographical challenges. Currently, we park at the basement level and have to walk 15 steps from the basement up to the ground floor to even access the ground floor. I have a documented disability with a negative prognosis. I had back surgery in 1993, and now I have arthritis, and and Dr. Rosran has said it's not going to get any better. And they're not doing spine replacements, unlike knees and hips and elbows. Our double lot, the only lot without vehicular access in Whitaker Road, without vehicular access to the ground floor. Everybody else parks at the ground floor and walks in at the ground floor, and they have their bedrooms at the ground floor. True, we have longer driveways, but we did this to preserve the rural character. The hearing right before us talked about buffers and how they were going to create buffers. We incurred the expense of putting in driveways and locating our house back on the middle of 2 3-acre lots, which we designed to preserve this rural character. We also didn't want people looking in our windows. And this was done to the community's benefit. We shouldered the expense and perils to preserve this rural character of the neighborhood. Our lower driveway, at best, you get a peekaboo view of the development on our lot. We willingly did what planners have to hold developers' feet to the fire to try to accomplish. And as you heard, with our proposals, we're impacting just over 5% of the lot that we purchase, combine, and pay taxes on. This is possibly the lowest percentage in the Whitaker Road development. Section D, circumstances not created by us. We didn't build in the critical area. I mean, we can't even see the water from our lot, except in hurricanes when it comes up into the wetland. It grew and expanded around us. True, we built a 2-small-bedroom, 3-story home, but it was done for all the right reasons. In fact, as we were building it, we actually warranted an article in the Washington Post for our leading edge environmental thinking. when we made our design and location decisions to put it where it was, for us to add the addition that we're proposing today to age in place, the additional bedroom and square footage, to get that permit, it would have been a simple matter going up to the courthouse and buying a building permit. We made the decisions we made for all the same reasons that you're concerned about tonight. Section E, not adversely affecting the environment. This is an important one. For 38 years, we made life choices to minimize our impacts on the environment. Small footprint house on a double lot to minimize impact, utilizing existing openings to minimize our impact originally and for this development. Utilizing existing footprint, the staff report suggested we might build over top the existing driveway. We'll talk about why that's just not practical, but what we were able to do is with the health department's approval, actually put part of the driveway on top of the septic tank, which is an impervious surface. The impracticality of adding to the west side of the house, the staff report not having the advantage of seeing the topo, suggests that it might minimize the impact putting it over the driveway. We did it not only using existing topography, but we're moving away from the sensitive areas. Jutland Creek is located to our west. We're moving toward the east. We're putting more pollution abating wetlands, which we own, between our addition and the creek and the Chesapeake Bay that we're trying to protect. On the southwest side, the living floor is 9 feet above grade. That would be an additional hardship, expense, environmental impacts of building up at that height. I don't know how you put a garage door and access that garage door if it's 9 feet above the driveway. Ours is the only on-grade option, minimizing construction environmental impact. It's a smaller scope of work, less grading and excavating materials. We were asked, in the DNR planner asked us to consider FID. I actually called Claudia Jones to ask her what the FID was, and it turns out it's forced interior dwelling habitat for birds. And I explained what we were going to do, and it turns out we were on the same page. In preserving this habitat for interior dwelling birds, they recommend that you not develop further into the forest. We're not. We're developing toward Whitaker Road. We're also building toward the Mattapani Rural Development District's intensive development area of St. Inigo's Center. We're utilizing existing forest openings. We're moving toward the St. Inigo's Development District. And also our willingness to further enhance the FID as part of the scope of the mitigation that this project's going to require. The staff report referred to us already having two accesses to the house. We do not. We have one access that comes to the house at the basement level, and we have one access to the studio. The staff report suggests that we have two driveways to the house. We have two driveways, but I remind you that we had two lots and combined them to make one large lot. Had we not done that, there would be two driveways and two houses and two garages. So what we're suggesting is not a third driveway. We're asking for a spur off of one of our two driveways, the one driveway per 3 acres. And the topography, we need two driveways. One comes in on the higher part of our 6-acre lot. The other one comes in below the Whitaker Road drop. The staff report also suggested that we might just drive from the existing driveway at the basement around the north side of the house. Well, there's a 9-10 foot elevation change there, and if you take the shortest route, that's going to present a 10% slope. That's pretty steep. A boat ramp that you put your boat in the water is 15%. And that slope would present us as seniors the challenges. My mother actually ended up in the hospital because she stepped on a gumball on a slope like that, went down, broke her wrist, ended up in the hospital. Flat is good for seniors. But even if we use the longest route, we'd have to back all the way up to my existing shop. We can double the length, but the slope is still going to be 5% and would require the removal of a dozen or more trees. The shorter route would require the removal of 4 or 5 trees. And you also end up with a slope driveway with those challenges. When I got my green card from the Soil Conservation Service when the county adopted the new standards, one thing I remember was you get your runoff into sheets. You don't want it to come down corridors, because corridors erode, and then you have a point source of pollution. You want to get it into sheet. Our proposal only produces sheet runoff. Outright, no tree loss, no excavation. Our proposed driveway is the minimum in both of the staff recommendations driving around. 100% of their proposal is in the critical area buffer. If you were to draw a straight line from our garage, the shortest distance to the edge of the buffer and a flat line, in other words, if you draw the shortest, straightest, flattest line from our garage to the closest edge of the buffer, you have our proposal. And it's also the reason we put that clearing there initially, because it was the shortest route and required the removing the least tree. It's not a third driveway. It's a spur off an existing driveway. Hazardous trees necessitate more parking. We have several parking spaces, but at any one time, maybe a third or a fourth of that's not accessible to us because of hazardous tree branches or hazardous trees that if the wind blows during the night, they're going to drop on our vehicle. I could also articulate that there are only two vehicles involved, and dilution is often the solution to pollution. By us being able to park our vehicles in four or five spaces, that's a less of an impact than if you constantly park two vehicles in two parking spaces. I would point out that our large parking lots, as referred to in the staff report, would not be approved if as dimensioned in a state park. They'd be too small. Multiple options minimum, we talked about that. And I would remind you that what we're proposing is the same as one driveway per 3 acres, which is the standard in Whitaker Road. Our house was originally situated to minimize environmental impact. Our green design warranted an article in the Washington Post. Our 1980 green design included a small footprint, a cube design minimizing materials, energy loss due to minimal surface area and minimal energy use. We oriented it facing south with glass in the south side for solar gain. We built into a south-facing slope with evergreen vegetation to the north, which I'm constantly planting more to break the north winds and deciduous trees dropping their leaves, which I continue to plant to the south so we get the solar gain in the winter. Natural cooling is provided by the clerestory windows. We used existing openings as much as possible then to minimize the impact, and we're doing the same now. Our proposed driveway is using an existing corridor. Our proposed addition is driveway spur would be farthest from Smith's Creek. In summary, our proposal is farthest from Smith's Creek. It's farthest from the stream on our property. It utilizes existing openings. It does not require tree removal. It minimizes erosion mechanisms. It's supported by the Soil Conservation Service and plan. A plan that we weren't required to do, but I met with Bruce Young, someone I used to work with, and he helped us develop a plan, and he's on board. It minimizes unwarranted hardship. It minimizes the road in the buffer. It's the safest option for us as residents in our age, and utilizes natural topography. The existing service road uses natural topography to access the garage. It's consistent with our forest living plan and minimizes the perils of woodland living. It's the flattest topography, least in the buffer. Section F, minimum achieve our age in place goals. Our proposal, in addition to utilizing existing clearing, our original addition footprint, our first version, our wish list had 960 square feet of living space. We moved everything that we didn't have on the living on our main floor there. It included access hallway, walk-in closet, main floor powder room, hall closet, mud room, large master bath, bedroom, and a laundry room, all ADA compliant to commercial standards. We've voluntarily already reduced this, partially because of cost. The addition is no longer ADA compliant. We've reduced it from 960 to, which is almost 1,000 square feet, to 519. This doesn't include the garage. Already we've reduced it, we've minimized our impact 50%. And that 519 includes that access bridge that bridges the grounds, not in contact ground. The water can run right under it. The reduced floor plan, we eliminated our walk-in closet, the laundry room, the coat closet, the mud room, and made all the saved areas smaller, thus no longer ADA compliant. We no longer have a space beside the toilet to park the wheelchair, should we ever become wheelchair dependent. We laid the groundwork to minimize, on these minimizing strategies when we bought the double lot and combined them to make one, and we've utilized flattest existing, clearest, and shortest routes for our road, also doing the same for the addition. I'll conclude. I spent 30 years as a park ranger caring for the environment. I can honestly say that we've done a better job managing our personal property with regards to minimizing our impact to the bay and preserving water quality than I was allowed to do as a manager with the Department of Natural Resources. I thank you for your time, and I thank you for holding your questions, and if you have any questions, my wife would be glad to answer them.
I have a question. Can I get you to back up to the slide where you reduced the footprint?
That's slide 65.
This is the reduced.
To the next one.
Huh?
The next one, I have 66.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that.
Can I ask why you reduced it?
I'm sorry?
Can I ask why you reduced it?
I mentioned I'm a retired park ranger, right? You can go on record and go on and see what salary. And I was a law enforcement officer, so I retired on 25/50th of a pay. If your total living space is less than 3,000 square feet, you can get the permit without having to redo your septic system, and that was a matter of expense, because if you go redoing the septic system wasn't a barrier. In fact, I actually went back over and I had a license to do septic systems prior to my back surgery in 1993, and I thought that was something I was going to do when I retired. But just like building a three-story house, I wasn't a visionary as to what kind of condition I'd be in when I retired and getting shaken around on a backhoe. But I went and got my permit. I still have my dump truck, 9-ton trailer, backhoe. I got the provisional permit, but then I was informed I'd have to do the nutrient removal system, additional drain fields. And as the staff report said, it is low, and I don't have that required three. The minimum depth of the septic system is 2 feet, and you're required to have 3 feet between that 2 feet and the water table. I just don't have that. So we were looking at the expense of a mound and nutrient removal system. There are grants available, but we're low on the list because our system is working great. And I've mitigated the nitrogen. Nitrogen removal systems are great if you're on a little tiny postage stamp. But we've got the idea. We have vegetation. We have trees. My favorite tree to plant are locust trees. They're legumes. They fix nitrogen. On the bottom side of my septic system, I've installed a nitrogen removal trench. That's a trench with organic material that doesn't use Smeco Electric to remove the nitrogen, but uses environmental chemistry to remove the nitrogen. I have a file this thick on natural alternatives to minimize that. And it's somewhat of a hobby. It was my career. And I do it for the bay. I don't do it to save the money. I don't do it, you know. It was my life's work. But I actually went to that 519 square feet came from the sanitarium. I actually sat down with the sanitarium with our existing plan. I would say that our existing plan is the square footage is actually more than what we have, but I asked her where she got that number. She said she got that from the tax office. The only way she could change that number would be to appeal my property taxes and get that number reduced. If I could get that number reduced, it was only 20-some square feet. We could have added that to the addition and not been doing. But I just hate, if you have something that's working well, I just hate to go into it. And
the reason I asked the question, because you keep referring back to the aging living and moving forward into the future, and you've removed all of the ADA compliances that you would want into the aging living, and you've removed all the other niceties that you would need for that as well, but your garage is bigger than the house.
Yeah, well, the garage.
I just don't understand. You presented your case.
The garage doesn't include.
Let me finish my comment. Okay.
So we didn't have that requirement, but also.
Let me finish my comment, please.
Okay.
Your presentation tonight is all on basically ADA and the living age that you're getting into. And what you've presented here is just a standard house. You've removed all of the amenities that would help you in that process as you move forward in the living age is what you refer to in your presentation here. And you reduce that and you're putting it back to a standard house that's really not going to help you except for a bedroom on the ground floor.
That's a major concern, a bedroom on the main floor and also the third bedroom also. It takes a small two-bedroom home and gives it a third, which adds to the saleability. And that house is our largest asset. When it comes time to move from living on our own to assisted living, liquidation of that asset. But also the it's a one-car garage, but if you, like I say, we were caretakers for our parents and we're all the time dealing with aged people, where an able-bodied person can get out of a car and squeeze around an open door, you're talking about needing room for the door to be open on the vehicle and still have access around it. That space in there, some things that I hope to be able to continue to tinker, and I hope to be able to put workbenches out there and be able to have access to that. My dad, up until he died at 89, and he was still able to go out and tinker with lawnmowers and boats and that sort of thing. Well, I won't be able to get out to my existing garage because of its proximity from the house. I will be able to continue my hobbies in that area. That's important to me. The bedroom on the ground floor is huge, and it does give us the bathroom on that ground floor. Right now, our master bath is up on the third floor. It seemed like a good idea when we were in our 20s. I recall my dad saying, "Why in the world on such a big lot are you building such a small footprint house? Why don't you build a rancher? You could build the whole house with a stepladder." I remember him saying that as he was helping me pass things up the scaffolding, building this this huge, huge house. And cost. We did send that plan to we talked to the Adamses, we talked to Duncan Leper, and for everything that we wished we had, it came in what, close to $250,000, and you do the best you can to provide for yourself to keep yourself out of a crisis with the resources that you have. I mean, the reason we're here making this presentation tonight and didn't hire professionals, I enjoy doing it, but the professionals don't do it for free.
Right. Understood.
And you have a question? For the $500 I had to pay to get here before you, I could have bought a lot of cinder blocks.
That's Pedersky.
This is completely different from what you've been talking about, but in the critical areas, the their letter, it suggests they move the garage and everything on the other side of the house.
She didn't have the topo. I talked to her, and when I explained the topo, she said, "Well,
I'm looking at what you have here, and it appears that most of that's on the same level, where it says shop and studio. It doesn't look like it's that much of a difference."
I'm sorry, Wayne.
On this here, the where the word studio is and shop on that side of the house, it doesn't look like it's the topo's that much difference from where you're at now.
I'm still. I don't know if it's hearing or I'm not following.
The wooded area.
I
know.
There's no trees here already. There's trees here.
Oh, there's no trees there already?
Right.
So if you go back to...
Yeah, right. Go to the loop.
Here.
Hey, Gene, you...
Yeah.
Yeah, the Gene's studio floor is just about the same level as the house.
Right.
Right. And the access we have to the house now comes in at the basement level.
Yeah, I see that.
And the upper driveway comes in at the higher level. Our upper driveway is about 10 feet higher than our lower driveway.
I've seen that, too. I understand that.
And the house that we live in, that's the smaller building.
That's clear. That's a clear area.
I considered going all the way down to the shop and then going to the left to get to that garage, but it would involve taking out trees. And it would also put just as much in the critical area. The existing, the clearing that we cleared, now admittedly, we cleared it to get the septic tank in there, and we just cut the trees all flush with the ground and backed over. The pine trees didn't come back. The maple trees and oaks, they would sucker up, and then next time we'd be able to drive over them. The pine trees rotted out, and I have to dump something, some old brick bat cinder blocks in there to get the Kevin's stool bus in there to pump the tank out. But it's something we've been, it's there. And
the,
yeah, no, go ahead.
Well, you're showing the septic tank underneath of the proposed driveway coming to the garage.
Yeah.
Your septic field's shown on here is on the opposite side of the lot.
Yeah, that's how I got the good deal on buying two lots. They didn't get a perk on the one of the lots. It would have perked because that sandy loam wraps all the way around that lower side, but they didn't know that. I wasn't going to call it to their attention. I made them a good offer.
You pump it from the tank to the field?
I'm sorry?
Do you pump it from the tank?
No, it's gravity. It's a gravity drain down around the end of the building there. And
then if you did relocate,
well, you got almost 12 feet fall between that septic tank and distribution box. I dig the trench and put a piece of schedule 40 in there and make the bubble touch, and then I do another 10 feet. And
well, that's clear.
It worked. It's working great.
And this is already cleared.
Why is that?
It's a gravity system. I've put in pump systems. I mean, they work, but if you can use gravity, gravity's preferred over a pump.
This is right here. Is this a path that is there?
When they did that original perk test, Clarence Fox was there, and we had to have, 3 5-gallon buckets of water. I dug the hole, and he had his stick, the tobacco stick with the nails in. I dumped the first two buckets in, and the water just disappeared, like dumping it in a. So then he put the stick in there, and he said, "Dump it in fast." And I dumped it in. It came up to the line, went right out, and he gave it the minimum, the best perk possible. It's you could dig that sand up and lay brick with it.
You have any additional questions?
Well, is what you're saying is this road that you're proposing is already there?
Sorry. Yeah, yeah.
And it's already been cleared.
It's been there since.
There's nothing there. Just
been there since 1980. Not as a road, but as a clearing. When you live in the forest, people that have lawn all the way around the house, if you need to get a pickup truck around to the other side, you drive around. We can't do that. If we need to get a bucket truck or get shingles delivered to the put up on the roof or need to get in there for any reason, we over the years we've used that clearing to access the back of the house and to access the septic tank. And what's there is serviceable. I mean, I don't propose bringing any more gravel in. If a pothole develops, I get a little gravel and put it into it. It's more of an incremental approach rather than a.
And how about where the house is? Is that where your drain fields is, the proposed house? I mean, the garage. Is that already cleared also?
It's open. Yeah. Don't we have a picture?
Yeah, but
it's utilizing existing footprint.
Drain,
that picture right there.
Yeah.
Is that it right there?
Yeah, Gene, put the one that shows.
Okay, here's the septic field right here.
Yeah, but show the one with the house with it. Show that clearing. Almost, it's slide number.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. It's tight. I mean, the trees are, I mean, we don't have to take any trees out.
Picture right there, is that where the garage is?
Yeah, the house
is
right there to the left. In fact, that's the top of the septic tank, and the garage door is going to be right there to your left
we got the house into it.
And that's the side of the house that it's attaching to?
That's the side that it's attaching to, yep. That's the side that we use now. It's the only on-grade side. We built that house right into the hillside. On the walkout basement side, we're at the lower grade.
Do you have the...
Like looking at motion pictures there.
Yeah.
See the blue, that's where the addition will go.
That's where the addition's going, right there.
There's the addition, yeah.
And this is the, these are the access to the septic tank?
That's the septic tank. I had to uncover that septic tank for the sanitarians to look at it, so I, you know, after I uncovered it, because they had to look at, I had to pour an 8-inch engineered slab over the entire thing.
And could you show where the driveway's going? Because it shows where some of that's clear, too.
Yeah.
This is coming in, and this is...
Might see some of it from, didn't you have a shot looking in the driveway toward the studio?
Yes. What number?
It's a long...
Sorry.
Okay, look at that.
Here's the, this is the existing road, access road.
Yeah.
And Whitaker Road is out there.
And that's...
What's that stake?
We had to stake it for the health department.
Yeah, the health department needed the corners of the house staked out.
Of the addition.
That, as I recall, was one of the corners of the garage portion. You can see the gravel that's on top of the septic tank, and it follows right into the one car, one door garage. There's going to be some fill to put in there. I mean, by the time I put that garage floor, the code allows you to have a garage floor. It used to be, had to be 3 inches below grade, but as long as it slants to the garage door, you can put that garage floor at the living level. So that's our goal. We have to put 18 inches or so of gravel in there and then put the concrete on top of that. But we won't have any steps to get between the house and the garage.
Who's going to do this work for you?
Well, the original house, I was the contractor and Gene was my labor, but that's not, I've talked to John Adams about doing it, Mike Adams, I've talked to Duncan Lepper. Now we're going to have to, I've never contracted, I've done a lot of contract work, but I've, and I am currently still licensed by St. Mary's County as a general contractor, as well as having a provisional septic license and holding a green card. But the scope of the work is just too much for me to take on at this time in my life. So I really have one of the St. Mary's County licensed contractors. But yeah, and their willingness to work around my trees, because most people would put that orange fence right up against the tree trunks. I look up at my, I like to keep everybody out of the, I want the footprint to be outside the drip line of my trees, because you know if you disturb right up those trees, they're going to
suffer. That way you can preserve the roots as well.
Yeah, the roots, yeah, but you know, what's in the ground is as important as what's above your head.
Do I understand you correctly that you don't intend to, for this proposed driveway, that you don't intend to put any, what kind of coverage do you plan to?
Oh, you mean what type of surface?
Yeah.
Local bank run gravel.
Gravel.
Strong material. You know, I tell him what I need, and he'll bring something, and I use as little of that as I can. And then to keep it clean, I've been going with bluestone because it's clean, and when rain doesn't run off of it quickly, and this driveway's flat, so the rain just kind of, in fact, on the slides of where we park our car, you'll see that bluestone, and I've actually, for any water coming off that slope, you'll see a rock wall there, and that catches the water, and the water just kind of percolates across that driveway, forms a sheet, and then goes off the driveway into the woods and down to the stream. It's not of a sheet
sheet water runoff is the ideal, and if you have to put water into a channel, you want to get it into a sheet as fast as possible. That way, the water doesn't approach erosion velocities, because once it's eroding, erosion velocity is higher, and then carrying velocity is lower. But once you get that water going fast enough to erode, you know, good luck getting, you know, you're going to get gully erosion and everything else.
So when you build the garage and all on the other side, you'll have some little bit of parking out front?
I'm sorry?
You have some parking out front of your other garage when you build it?
The new garage? No, we... You mean addition to the... No, we're not proposing. We're not proposing that. I see one vehicle remaining down in the lower driveway. It's been my experience in dealing with my parents that you end up only needing one vehicle.
And what's on that? What's the topping down below? Is that blue chip?
Yeah, that's... It's blue chip. I put that in when they were redoing Route 5 from Rayleigh Store down to Trossbeck, and my cousin Jarbo did that job, and I knew the guys, and after they took the asphalt out of there, they took the grader in the evening, scraped up the substrate and piled it in piles there at the Scotland Post Office, and then on Saturday we went down there and got it and put it on my driveway. So that's what that driveway is made out of.
People know that.
A little piece of, you didn't even know about.
Yeah, I really didn't even know that. So I got where I'm going is, my question is, if you're proposing a new garage and a new entrance to that thing, and removing some of the cars from this parking, are you willing to give up some of this parking on this side?
Yeah. You mean
eliminate it.
Eliminating some of that, yeah, if we don't need it. Probably place to give it up would be the parking up at the studio. Other than access there, as we wind down our careers, it's probably going to be the one at the basement of the house. I would imagine a caregiver could continue to use that one.
What's the square footage of the road from your garage to the critical area buffer line?
Just that little.
No, do you know what square footage that is?
No, I don't have that. I mean, I have
It's on the site plan, though.
What is? No, that's the entire one. But he's asking from that red line on the critical area buffer to the garage. We had the total. It was about half the total, I would guess.
Yeah.
Maybe a little less than half. Just
from this critical area to the garage.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking at. Yeah.
Just looking at slide number 8, I would say that is about equivalent to running the shortest distance around to the shortest driveway, and I had measured that to be about 100 feet, so about 100 feet in length, because it was 200 feet from the door back to the existing driveway and the shop. About 100 feet.
So it's about 800 square foot then. So about 800 square foot. It's 8 foot wide.
Yeah.
I think if I was, if they were to move forward with this application, Steve, I think I would, especially in the critical area, I would look for like for like. You know, you're proposing inside the buffer, as far as the driveway is concerned, another 800 square foot that we would remove 800 square foot somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. I think the best place to take it would be at the studio, because...
Well, I think I would rather take it inside the critical area where you're putting it in, okay?
Oh, well,
so that would be down to the parking spaces and the extended drive down closer to the lower deck. That would be a like for like. I wouldn't want to take it out above the critical area when we're putting it in the critical area buffer. Okay, so that's what I would look at as a condition that we move forward. See, somewhere down in to the left side of the house, the existing house, between that and the shop somewhere in that area. And you said earlier that in your presentation about you couldn't do a lot of, and you had been to the doctors and they gave you a note, and we have a copy of that here.
Right.
But it's a 2015 dated. Is there anything, any more update than that?
Mr. Chairman, I did not understand that the applicant was claiming any present disability as opposed to anticipating the disabilities that come with age. Am I correct?
I've never claimed a disability. I have a letter from the doctor that says that I have a permanent disability, but...
But you're not making that a basis for your request?
No. My request is the anticipation. I can certainly climb 15 steps at this time, and if I did that, I'd have access. It's the prognosis and my experience with the rescue squad and dealing with my parents that a crisis is a big problem with short time to solve it.
Understood.
Right now I'm 60. You know, if we have a problem on the horizon, do we wait until we have no time to solve it and go right up to it? That's what a lot of people do. You know, I like, if you have a problem of a given size, use as much time in front of it to avoid being in crisis mode. And that's why we're here tonight. You know, I don't see the need for this next week or hopefully not next year. But the eventuality is if dad, before he died, he couldn't walk to the bathroom. Mom couldn't walk to the car. She was in a wheelchair and had to be carried. And they were still living at home.
Okay.
Luckily, they had a bedroom on the ground floor.
I was asking the question because it was in the packet.
Yeah. I'm sorry?
I was just asking the question because it was in the packet.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Anyone else have any questions?
No.
No.
Thank you. Any other thing you want to present to the board?
I can't do anything right the first time. You can ask my IT department.
Is that it?
That's all I have.
We will open a public testimony. Anyone wishing to speak on this case this evening? Seeing none, we'll close public testimony. Any comments from the board?
Being that most of it's already cleared with an addition's gone in the garage and the road's already there too, I understand what the critical area commission's saying, and if there was a bunch of trees and a bunch of stuff that had to be removed, I would be against this that is proposed. But because there's nothing being removed or very little at least, I don't have a problem with this.
Okay. Any other comments?
I support what Mr. Medinsky is saying.
Okay. The only
Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
Staff's a bit confused. This is the first we've heard that there's an existing road. So why are they proposing a driveway if it's already existing?
Well,
why would you even apply for a driveway if it's already existing? I don't understand this.
My understanding, it doesn't. When I went in to apply for the building permit with Mr. Knight, I said the road's already there. He said it's not there unless it's on the site plan. And you failed to put it on the site plan when we applied for that permit for the entrance in 2010. That was our mistake. It was there. We used it to build the entrance. So. Barely using it now, but
it says proposed.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to point out that neither St. Mary's County nor the Department of Land Use is a party to this proceeding. I just wanted to point out that neither St. Mary's County, neither the commissioners of St. Mary's County,
nor the Department of Land Use and Growth Management is a party to this hearing. The county is not a party to this hearing unless it chooses to intervene. It has not chosen to intervene.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure what that means.
I'm not either.
It means that it's not the role of the department beyond its submission of its staff report to interrogate witnesses or to advocate for a result.
Mr. Chairman, I'm trying to understand what the variance request was for.
No, sir. They are not parties to the proceeding.
Okay.
I don't appreciate that.
I'd go on record. I have no problem working. I think those people over in planning zoning, they have a thankless job, and I wouldn't have it for any amount of money. I'd certainly be willing to answer any questions, concerns that they have.
You can clarify it with staff later.
Yeah.
Okay. Your question again, Mr. Ledesky?
No, I wasn't a question. That was just a comment. That's how I feel. If I thought it was some way to reduce something at this point that would help, you know, mitigate this, I'd be all in favor of it.
I think we can.
If you can make a suggestion.
Right. I think what I said and mentioned earlier, that the driveway, even though it could be existing there, okay, is leading into the new part of the residence, and it's 800 square foot inside of the buffer.
Mm-hmm.
That we take 800 foot from another location outside of that buffer.
Can we reduce that in that part?
I don't see where you could take it from.
Well, the parking spots on the other side. He's using the garage for the cars to park right there to the left of that residence.
The down at the bottom where the basin is.
Yep.
You could get some.
Between that and the shed is all that's in the buffer.
You could get some, but you couldn't get 800 feet.
You still need
that access.
Yeah.
Part of that driveway is on existing septic tank. I mean, that septic tank is a big piece of impervious. I mean, that's not everything. I see what you're saying. It's right in the critical area, but it's already impervious. It's the equivalent. That septic tank is equivalent. Since we built the house, that septic tank is equivalent to the driveway, and that septic tank is in that. If we could be given a couple hundred square feet for that and get it down to 600 square feet, I could narrow that lower driveway from the 10 feet that it is and snug it in. It's a long driveway. You take 2 foot off the side of that driveway.
I think he takes enough to the parking spots at the lower level. He can get that. I think you can get that.
I'm okay.
I think we just do the
you're allowed to make a comment.
Mm-hmm. No, I think you can only get maybe 20 square feet by doing that. So, I mean, I 20 feet square here, 20 feet there, but it's not going to add up to 800 square feet.
No.
So, I mean, that's why I think it's immaterial. I think it's in.
Okay. Anyone else have any questions or comments? I'm open for motion, but I would like to put a friendly condition in there for that.
Well, let's talk about that. Okay. He's not going to be able to get 800 square feet out of.
And you have to leave enough room at the bottom that you can turn around.
Yeah, so he still has to have,
you can't collapse that entire parking spot.
No, exactly. He can't collapse this down. He can't collapse that down, so there's no room there. I think it's.
If this is drawn to scale, that's 8 foot. If you took some of this parking out here and up towards this shop that's inside here, that's a lot of open area right there. That thing is 25 foot wide, going up to that shop. If this is to scale.
Yeah. Is there a particular task that you do in one time mitigation?
No, but you,
I understand
task, right. You have to do.
You take some of this and then some of this back out up to here. I think you could do away with some of it, but.
Considering we're only dealing with estimates.
Yep.
It's kind of tough to put it in.
Yeah, I would. Yeah, Mr. Young pointed out that that line that delineates the buffer That's foundationed on the line that's supposedly following the tidal wetland. Gene, can you find that slide? Now, Mr. Young, when he looked at that, he said, well, really, that line should be closer to your garage. And I actually explored the possibility, if I wanted to go to the expense of hiring surveyors and getting it all replotted.
This line should be following.
Right here. Mr. Hammond, if you're going to talk, you need to use that microphone there if you're going to. Okay.
Yeah. That lower starred line is supposed to be on top of that red line, because that line is supposedly the edge of the wetland.
Well, the only thing we can do is go by the drawing that we have in front of us.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know what latitude you have, but he pointed out that if that line were actually moved down to where, if that line were moved down to the red line, that would pull that other line closer to the.
Understood.
Close. I mean, I want you to feel good about what decision you make here tonight. I appreciate the thankless job you've got, but we're all trying to get to the same place. If I go down there ripping up existing driveways, you know, even if you put filter fence and that sort of thing, it is going to be work and grading and excavating, that sort of thing, in the critical.
But it's evident you're good at that because you've been doing it for. It's evident you're good at that because you've been doing it for 38 years,
yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah, a job spread over 38 right. years isn't like.
All right. I'm just looking to get something back.
If
the rest of the board is not there, we'll just move on.
You just want to just make a motion without that? And then
having to rip out something you've already done is like orphaning your children.
Okay. You ready? In the matter of VAAP 15-0690, Hammond property, having made a finding that the standards for granting a variance in the critical area and the objectives of section 71.8.3 of the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance have been met, I move to approve the variance request to disturb the critical area buffer to construct an addition to the existing single-family dwelling.
I have a motion.
I have a second motion.
And second. And we'll start with Mr. Medeski.
Yes.
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 No.
Yes. As you can see, Mr. Hammett, the board voted 4-1 to support your request this evening, okay? An order reflecting the board's decision will be prepared by staff and signed by the board within 30 days. A 30-day period follows from the date the order is signed, during which any agreed party may appeal the board's decision to circuit court. Any action taken during that time, you'll do it at your own risk, and we'll mail you a copy of the order once it's signed. Okay? So what I've just said is your application was approved this evening.
Okay.
Okay?
At what point can we go get a permit?
Once the order is signed by the board in 30 days, then we'll mail you a copy of that, and then you can start with your permit process.
Okay.
Okay?
Appreciate it, and thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good evening. Can we take a 10-minute break?
Yeah.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we're back in line. All right, we're back in session. Our next case this evening is conditional use request CUAP 13-135-002, the Bishop Oil Company Incorporated property. And this case was continued from July and August, and now we're here in October to hear this case. Let me just kind of bring everybody up to speed where we get left off. We did have staff report, they did their presentation. We opened the hearing, staff did their presentation, and we asked for 10 items from the applicant that night to bring back when he was ready to present his case. And the first one was a representation from Bessier Oil Company and Washington Gas, full radius easement, full radius on existing towers, and we asked for D-size documentation, and we didn't get those until tonight. It would have been nice to have had those so we could have looked at those prior to tonight. Exact location of the monopole on the plan, why that location was chosen, why they are not seeking co-location site on county property, FAA letter, FCC letter, any assessments completed on other sites for the placement of this tower, and evidence that it satisfies all federal and state legal requirements to construct this tower and place equipment on the tower. That's where we left off from our last hearing. And so who's making the presentation this evening?
Yes, I will be making the presentation, which will start with a PowerPoint, about 15 slides, and that will also be followed by going through those additional documents you listed off as well.
Okay. And if you would, your name and address, please.
Yes, my name is Ben Pelletier.
Spell the last, please.
P-E-L-L-E-T-I-E-R.
Okay. And let me get you sworn in. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay. And will these gentlemen be making presentations as well or comments?
Potentially, so yes, we should swear them in.
Okay, so you first, sir.
Orlando,
your name?
Spencer. Orlando Spencer.
Spencer?
Yes.
Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Dwayne Kincaid.
Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, response, and statements you may give with whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
And you, sir?
Antonio Ancona.
Can you spell that last name, sir?
Pardon me?
Can you spell that last name, please?
A-N-C-O-N-A.
Ancona? Okay. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. This is the tower replacement proposed at 22348 Three Notch Road. There are two existing 175-foot guy towers on this property. They were constructed in 1998 and have had 117 above mean sea level. Here's a better angle of these two guy towers. The one on the right, as you can see, is filled to the brim, so to speak. And the one on the left has two antennas about halfway down. Those are currently Washington Gas antennas on that tower. The reason we're having to propose a replacement is because that tower on the left was not designed for the larger panel and parabolic dishes. It was designed for smaller whip antennas, not a whole lot of wind sail and weight overall. So any dish, and it doesn't matter moving around antennas from one tower to the next, one of those towers is going to fail. So that's why we're here. Tower on the right is to remain, and the tower on the left is to be replaced. Just an aerial of the property. I've color-coded this just to make it easier. The red triangle with the yellow infill is the existing 175-foot guy tower that's to be removed. That blue dot is the proposed monopole. That's the replacement. And when we get to the drawings, I can show you the setback radius. The reason why that monopole is set back further is to pull it off of the adjacent properties due to the county zoning ordinance, calling for a one-to-one setback from adjacent properties. This is again showing the existing guy tower that has a lot of appurtenances attached to it. Washington Gas needs to be at 172 and 138 to make their point-to-point contact with these microwave dishes. So just give you a visual of where they would need to be on that current tower. This is the proposed monopole, giving you detail that, again, a three-foot dish at 172 feet and a four-foot dish at 138 feet for Washington Gas, and it leaves two open spaces, at least two open spaces, for future co-location. This shows Washington Gas's coverage objective, the existing Prince Frederick site, which is currently on air, and then how it works in relationship to the...
Excuse me, can you use your pointer and point to these sites?
Absolutely. To the north, you have the Prince Frederick site that's currently on air. It's existing for Washington Gas. Down south is the Lexington Park site that we're discussing today, and how those two hand off from each other with Washington Gas's network, which we can explain in just a minute. Further close-up of the proposed site, and the lighter blue color is showing that propagation and coverage for their internal communications. When looking through this, Washington Gas was considering multiple towers and ruling out these alternate candidates, so to speak. There is a very slender and much older guy tower on 46375 Peg Lane, just behind a church. It has two whip antennas. You cannot see the whip antennas on the picture. They're hard to see even in person, but it's 141 feet, and there's already two antennas up there, and it's not designed for heavier dishes that Washington Gas is proposing. This is a much shorter, like a stumpier, so to speak, monopole, 21768 South Coral Drive. This is just across on the other side of Three Notch Road from the weapons, or the, from Patuxent River Naval Air Station. It has three carriers currently. There's a whip on the very top and another whip just down from that. And then there's a carrier with a platform and some panel antennas. So it's not a very tall monopole to begin with. So you got three carriers right there, and you're left with about 20 feet left. This is 45900 Buck Hewitt Road. This is actually a SMECO tower. As you can see, they have, I say carriers, but I use that in the sense of rad centers and the antennas that are up there currently. Historically, SMECO is putting up towers just for SMECO. They don't lease. This is a private use, and it's just for their internal communications. With that said, still, there's a parabolic dish on the very top of the tower. It's kind of laying horizontally. There's two 20-foot whips coming off the sides, so that eats up the first 20 feet. Another parabolic dish and some panels, as well as a whip to the south of that. That right there eats up at least 50 feet, if not more, of that tower, leaving you the top hour antennas at about 133. And again, that magic number was the 172, 138 for Washington Gas's parabolic dishes. This is actually on the air station. It is a monopole that Verizon Wireless built several years ago. It's only 145 feet tall. There are three carriers there. That right there eats up 30 feet at least, which leaves you about, the top of Washington Gas's antennas would be about 115 at the highest, which still doesn't meet that magic number of 172 and 138. Now this is the much larger self-support tower over at the Volunteer Fire Station, 45774 Fire Department Lane. It's a 220-foot self-support tower. It boasts 17 carriers. That is a lot. If you do that math, I mean, you're eating up. I had to truncate this picture because I couldn't fit it all and make it clear at the same time. So it starts at 120 feet, and there are carriers even below 120 feet. And again, give you that visual, the 138, 172 is the magic mark for Washington Gas to make that happen. So that left us with this existing tower, which there are two towers on the Besh Oil property. One, as I mentioned, is frail. It's not designed for these heavier new antennas with more wind sail and more weight. So replacing it, not only replacing it, but bringing a new tower into conformance on that property, because the current towers are not in conformance with the zoning ordinance. These dishes and two smaller antennas that Washington Gas is using currently, they're for monitoring storage tanks and valves, as well as emergency communication and dispatch internally. So it's not, this isn't for Verizon Wireless to get better coverage, get more customers. This is for the safety of Washington Gas's clients, its own personnel, and to an extent, public safety as well for them. That's all I have for this PowerPoint. I do have a list of documents that we were asked for.
Okay, before we get going with those.
Absolutely.
You did do what we asked you to do as far as the co-locations on the mm-hmm. county sites and stuff. But there was also a request to, was there any other locations for this tower to go, any other properties that you investigated that this tower would not work on? That was another question as well.
Yes, we didn't analyze other raw land opportunities, so to speak. We were trying to look at situations where there are existing towers and to utilize that. And with something like this, we're putting in a monopole in an area where there's already existing towers. That means less clear cutting of trees and access roads. We don't have to clear cut. If we were going in an area that was wooded, which we preferred for buffering and screening, there'd be a lot more clear cutting and having to put in an access road. So we wanted to stick to an area where there are already towers there at present.
And I appreciate that. But where I'm going is that the towers that are there on the Beshe site were probably put in a few years ago that they probably met the codes then, okay? And what you're doing is replacing one, so you have to meet the codes today. And one of them is there's no structures within that fall range of that tower. So you don't meet that standard for that location.
Okay.
So just letting you know up front, that's one of the standards that you don't meet.
Correct, okay. And I guess with that said, the buildings, I don't know if that is taken into consideration, the buildings on the property are owned by Besh Oil.
Doesn't make any difference. So, but anyway, well, I'm going to let you finish your thing and then the board will make the decision.
The tower's designed that it will not fall, even for the tower to have any problem, you have to go with 212 mile an hour wind, which you're never going to get. So the tower is designed that cannot fall. It's like a building.
Maybe we won't get that win in our lifetime, okay? I understand what you're saying, and I appreciate your comments, but you can finish your, I'll let you finish your
and may I ask a question, actually, in regards to that? Does the county differentiate with buildings? You know, because at the base of a tower, obviously, you have shelters and things that are...
That's part of the tower.
So it's deemed part of the tower, regardless of that? Okay, so it's all external buildings not related to that?
Correct.
Okay. Understood.
Okay.
The additional documentation I have, I'll pass out these copies. I deliver copies of the full-size drawings as well as these documents about 2 weeks ago via FedEx. I don't know if these were disseminated to the board. It sounds like they may not have been.
We got them tonight.
You got them tonight? Okay. All right. Well, I'll hand them out regardless. So we'll go from top document down to the bottom. The first document dated August 3rd, 2016 was per the county zoning ordinance that required if a tower setback was encroaching on someone's property, we needed a notarized document or an easement. We went for this notarized document from the adjacent property owner who has signed and notarized it, obviously. With the understanding that the tower was encroaching on their property.
And can you show me on a drawing where that is?
Absolutely.
You don't have it up here?
No, it's the, you lose the imaging on this particular drawing.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You need to speak in the mic.
Yes, I was losing quality with trying to put this specific drawing into a PowerPoint presentation. I do have copies of these drawings again to disseminate.
We have them here, I think.
You do have them there? The sheet I'm going to reference specifically, minor site plan, C1.
This is what we got in our packet with these, this size hole.
Okay.
And you can't read them.
Yeah, and that's why I actually, and I know she's not present, so I apologize. I have email interactions with Yvonne Chalet, where I FedExed her two separate packages with full-size drawings, and she acknowledged them. So I'm not sure if that was a breakdown in communication.
Which drawing are you looking at?
The minor site plan, page C1.
Okay.
If you look towards the right, there's a number, triangle with a number 2 in it. Just above that is a cloud that says easement, and it's pointing to a hatched area. That was the encroaching area of the tower setback.
Which one is it again?
C1.
C1?
Yeah, second page.
Yeah. Okay. This is the right one. Okay.
Correct. Yep. There's a number 2 in a triangle.
Yes.
That cloud that says easement. This is the hatched area that let the adjacent property owner know that that setback was on their property.
Okay.
To the extent.
And that's the fall radius or not? Where's your tower?
Yeah, that's it. That's the tower, and that solid line is a setback.
That's
the, per
okay.
The zoning ordinance. It's
okay.
The 1-to-1.
Okay.
The easement is in a hashed area?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, over here.
Now, on that same site plan, you can see the other two guy towers, and those existing setback radii are showed as well with some dotted lines.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Called out as tower to be replaced setback and tower to remain setback with different weight dashed lines, showing you where those currently sit on the adjacent properties, and they encroach on multiple properties.
What building is this 118?
So that is the gas station that is there currently?
Yes.
On the Besh Oil property?
Okay. And then there's another building over here. Which one is that?
I'm not sure. I'm the property owner is here, so we may actually
okay.
ask him.
Okay. This one doesn't.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
The building?
That's a shed, is it?
Okay. Let's move on.
Second document in the packet, also dated August 3rd, 2016. It's a signed and sealed, we call it non-interference letter. This is a basic letter and language that we use during permitting purposes. Many counties require a non-interference letter, just stating that these proposed ordinances won't interfere with county equipment, et cetera. Here we have a submission for FAA. The submission actually occurred towards the beginning of September. It was not accepted by the FAA until 9/19. So that is not approved currently. It's in for review and it's due out at the end of this month. That's one of the items we do not have currently. But the consulting firm, EBI, who submitted it for us, analyzed this and the other towers they've done in the area and feel that it should be no issue.
But you don't have a letter from FAA?
Currently, we do not have a letter, correct.
Or a trickle-down from Maryland Aviation either, right?
For MAA?
For MAA.
Correct, yep. And in our experience, when you do the FAA...
It should be a trickle-down.
It typically encompasses the MAA.
But they send a separate letter usually.
Correct, they do, yep. And I've, on a smaller level, BWI requires one, but it doesn't require FAA. So it's, you know, if you go to MAA, obviously it says MAA. If you do FAA, it trickles down, as you have said, and both agencies play a part in giving that approval.
If you're based, you usually expect something from the Navy also, trickling off the FAA letter.
Okay. And what was provided in the FedEx were actually color copies of these propagation maps showing Washington Gas's coverage for their communications. First one shows proposed site on air with neighbors. I can actually pull that back up in the presentation. So this is the full coverage objective, again, showing the Prince Frederick site to the north and the Lexington Park proposed site to the south, and how those two hand off with each other. Really, the coverage objective is this southern tip in St. Mary's County, especially around the base for Washington Gas. The rest of the propagation maps show the site off air completely, just so you have a side-by-side, and then again with the proposed site on air. That concludes a follow-up on these documentations.
Any questions?
Not about that, but I'm concerned about the building 118. Okay. That's
all right. Who's from Beshe? Who's directly from Beshe? Okay, Mr. Kincaid, right?
Okay.
You got a question for him?
Yeah. What's going on with that building? With the old gas station?
Yeah, I believe that's a shed behind the old gas station. Behind the gas station. The Beshe Oil Sunoco station.
And they're directly affected by the fall radius. I don't know if there's anything else that's really...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All this is part of the tower, I think. Yeah, but yeah, it's three different buildings there.
This is so small. What's it's a building 8, a building 9?
Those are all in that area of 8, 9, 4, Forts of Fang, excuse me, then 10. Those are all shelters, and some of the carriers have actually used, they took sheds, put a shed down on the ground, and that's their shelter for the communications facility.
Okay.
What do you intend to use?
Washington Gas intends to put a shelter in there.
And what's going to happen with the other shelters?
Well, the other shelters aren't going away. They're there because all the carriers are staying.
You're removing an antenna.
Come again?
On that antenna.
I'm sorry.
You said you were going to remove an antenna, correct?
That's on the tower currently?
I'm sorry, you're going to remove a tower?
A tower.
A tower, yes.
So what's on the tower that you're going to remove?
What's on the tower that we're going to remove?
Is there a shelter there that you're going to remove?
That supports that tower.
Yeah, that supports that
tower. Oh, I don't think there's any shelters being removed in regards to this tower. All the other shelters are staying in place, and Washington Gas is proposing a new shelter. Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, the current antenna on the existing tower is Washington Gas's, and we got to keep that shelter. I think it's shelter 9 is the one that we currently use.
All the shelters will be remaining for the current carriers.
Okay.
On the antenna that's not being removed, are there any carriers that are not active?
Not active? Not that I know of. I can't speak to that.
When we first proposed this, we removed all of the active antennas off the small tower. Because it was, both towers were at capacity. And Washington Gas needed a spot temporarily. So we put that onto the small tower that we want to remove until we get the monopole put up. And it'll be moved there. And then also have the dishes added to the new monopole.
There's also a second dish that will be added to the new tower that's not on the existing tower.
Those were the two dishes we talked about, correct? The 3 foot and the 4 foot at 172 and 138 is what you're describing.
Mm-hmm.
What was that again? Kind of low in volume.
On the existing tower, the one that's going to remain, you see on there, there's one parabolic dish, but there's actually supposed to be two dishes, but the existing tower cannot handle the load. So that would not be installed until the new tower was built. And that's at that 138, 172 level.
But does it feed to the same?
Yes.
So if you had put one up on Peg Road, you would have still had only one parabolic dish or whatever, right?
Okay.
In other words, if it was not adjacent, two towers adjacent to one another, you would still, you'd be forced to just have one, and that's it.
That's correct, but we would experience a fading, which we currently do now.
You'd have to relocate and put two on the new tower elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have any questions?
I'm still confused about the three buildings. All three of those are going to stay. Both of them say 118 on the C1 plan.
Yes.
You got one that's like a L, and then the other one's
yes.
What, the old gas station.
Yes.
And the other 118, what was that? The office for Deshi?
Yes, sir.
That's where the. Yes. What's the other smaller
that's
one?
That's a shed.
And just the shed.
Yes, behind the gas station.
What's that used for?
That's for I don't know. That's the.
Storage?
Yeah, it's storage for the gas station.
And what are you doing with the gas station now? Is it closed? Or?
No, I think it's still operating. I think.
So we really don't know. Now, you're the representative from Deshi, but we don't really know whether that's...
Yeah, I'm not representing Deshi Oil. I'm representing Mr. Deshi as the landowner.
Okay.
As where the towers are located on his land. So I have very little knowledge of Deshi Oil.
Okay.
I have a lot of concerns, okay, that this, I can't help what was put back 20 years ago on this site, okay, but what we're going to look at, either approving or disapproving, I have a hard time approving a tower that has several buildings in its fall zone, okay, even though it may not fall with the 212 mile an hour winds, it doesn't meet, I've been a stickler on this because we've had other people, Verizon and rest of them, either move the tower or go find another location. Okay, I'm not comfortable with this right now at all. We don't even know whether the buildings are even operational at this point. So there's some information that we don't have. There's information that we asked for some time ago on our last go around. To seek out different sites that other than the towers that you sought, and that was great. I appreciate that piece of it, but I would be more comfortable moving forward with this application if that pole was in a different spot. and we didn't have anything in the fall radius. That's where I'm at this point, okay? And you have four other members here that have their opinion as well, okay? But, all right, anything else that you had to present to the board this evening?
That's all I have. Thank you.
Gentlemen, anything else? Okay. We'll open it to public testimony. Seeing none, we'll close public testimony. Any comments or questions for the board?
What do you need this for exactly? What is this exactly going to do for you?
Yeah, primarily it's used for dispatching personnel for maintenance and emergencies. We control the pipeline, the flow of gas, the pressures in it. The new initiative that we're doing is we're putting in remote control valves so that if you have a rupture, we don't have to actually be on site to close that valve to shut that gas. We can do it remotely from our main office in Springfield.
So you definitely need a tower?
Yeah, we got to have the coverage in order to operate these remote control valves.
And I don't have a problem with the tower at all. And I know you all want to move forward with the technology and stuff to handle these. So it reduces a lot of service calls. I know it does.
Okay. Right.
But I just wish it was in a different location.
And it would be, to me, it would be one thing, you know, that with the Beshe and the Sir building, but it's open to the public. I mean, if people are coming and getting gas, that's open to the public. And we're putting them at risk, you know. Granted, if it's 200 mile an hour wind,
they're not going to be buying gas.
But
there's existing towers. It can fail anytime when heavy wind.
Understand, but those existing towers were put in under different standards 20, 25, 30 years ago.
I understand,
okay? But what we're looking at is today's standards, and that's what we have to follow, is today's standards, not what was put in 25 years ago.
But to make it clear, the tower it's not bound by where the pipeline is. It's because it's going to be a remote signal anyway, right?
No, that's correct. It's not bound by what.
You can place it around the county within some sort of range to where you would set up your remote sensor on your pipeline.
That's correct. But the importance about this location is it provides the correct propagation coverage to cover the entire pipeline in this area. Now, the problem, if we move it north, we're going to have a taller tower to create that same coverage. But right now, that in that location, it covers the entire pipeline, at least to the end of it in St. Mary's County.
But it has to be, and the signal has to be at a certain height for you.
Yes.
Correct.
Okay.
That's correct. Yeah.
But, okay.
Because we're limited by FCC rules as far as how much power we can put out. So when you compensate for that, is you go up in height.
Now, who's building the tower and will own the tower?
We're building the tower.
Washington Gas.
That's
so
correct.
So you will own the tower and just be leasing, paying lease or rent.
That's correct.
On the property you're going to put it on.
Right.
So literally you could go anywhere in the geographical area. Yeah, the other problem I have is we haven't cleared the FAA. Not that it may be appropriate, but still, you are very close to the base there. And I'd like to see that it's gone through the procedures. Mm-hmm. Besides, my personal opinion, how can we hold other people accountable by today's standards for this county, and then allow this one to be brand new to an old standard? I find that difficult.
Our intention was to do a one-to-one swap. We wanted to take down one tower and put up one tower. That's what it all started as. Yeah. But, you know, obviously there's the new rules now that apply, and that's why we're here for a variance.
And the other difference swaps for us is, you know, this is not a for-profit thing. It's for safety, public safety. So.
One day.
On the FAA question, the original tower required lights on it when it was put up in the past, and that requirement was removed. The height limit that we have at that particular site is 185 feet. It's approved by the FAA.
Yeah.
And this tower will be
175.
So there's almost a, even though we don't have it in our hand, it's almost a certainty that it will be approved.
I understand.
Okay.
Any other comments?
I'm not sure what to think you. If you had the stuff that we requested, that's fine. One problem I see in the Greater Lexington Park area is older. There won't be any replacement towers because everybody will be scrambling for new real estate. And to me, in and of itself, that's a problem. I think a replacement is appropriate. Although, on new construction, and I don't consider this, yeah, it is new, but it's a replacement. And I think a replacement should be honored. On new construction, I fervently agreed that nothing could be in the fall radius. I don't feel like I'm backtracking here because this is, I'm looking at each case independently, as I guess you're supposed to do when you're sitting up here. Thank you.
Any other comments? Hearing none, and I'm open for a motion.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
I'd kind of like to get an idea of how everybody is on this. You're against it.
I can't support it at this point.
Mr. Payne? You're against it?
I'm not supporting it.
Okay. Well, that makes it easier to make a motion. In the matter of CUAP 13-135-002, Bessie Oil Company Incorporated property, commercial communication tower, have made the finding that the standards for granting as conditional use and the objectives of section 51.3.91 of St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance have not been met. I move to deny the request to build a monopole-style commercial communication tower at the height of 175 feet above ground level. That's it.
We'll start with Mr. Green.
And I second.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Green?
No. Yes. For the motion?
Yes.
No.
Just want to clarify, if you vote yes, you're supporting the motion to deny.
Correct.
Right.
If you vote no, you're voting to approve the
Correct.
Tower.
Okay.
Yes.
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 Mr. Payne, you voted no. Is that correct?
Correct.
So you can see where the board voted tonight. Four voted against the application, seeing one voted for the application. So the applicant has been denied. The request has been denied this evening. And what I'll suggest is that look for other locations. Another location that we don't have the major issues that we spoke of tonight. We normally support the towers when they go up because, the FCC needs them to go up as well for different phones and things of that nature. And I know you really need it for your technology to support the safety of what you'll do in St. Mary's, okay? And I don't think there would be an issue if it was, we didn't have anything in that fall zone. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah, I just need to move it, find another location.
All right, our next case this evening is a conditional use request, CUAP 15-135-008, Brown Williams Property, Commercial Communications Tower. This is also a continued case from July 14, 2016. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So let me just bring us to speed where we are here. We opened the hearing up, and there was no presentation given by staff or by the applicant. So we're going to move forward with it. Staff's not here right now, so we're going to. You all got a copy of the staff report?
Yes.
From the county. So we're going to accept the staff report as written, okay, as part of the case this evening. Okay, since Ms. Michelle is not here to make the presentation.
I understand.
We do have Mr. Hunt here in the event that we have any questions for staff.
Okay.
So what we'll do is that we'll move right on into, Mr. Weiber, we'll move right on into your presentation.
Okay? Well, and recognizing your admonition that she's got a hard stop at 10 o'clock, and given the number of times we've been here before, I'm going to try and be very expeditious and get straight to what we believe are the issues that or questions that the board may have about the content of the application. With that, I'd I guess get Mr. Mudd and Mr. Fisher sworn in.
I will do that.
A couple brief questions, ask them.
Gentlemen, do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony responses to the statement you may give would be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. And if you would, for the record, give us your name and address, please.
Pat Mudd, Mudd Engineering. Mark Fisher, Managing Member, Telecom Capital Group.
All right. I'll could ask both of them the...
Manny working tonight, too?
He is. I think he was working Washington Gas. So.
Got caught up telling him that we just pulled the UNO on a site 1 mile away from their proposed site.
Okay. For the record, if you would, give us your name.
Manny DeRazia.
And I'll swear you in, too, please. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, response, and statement you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
All right, I'm going to ask all three of them the same question, and we'll get with one variation for Mr. Mudd, and then we'll get individual answers from each one of them. Have you reviewed the site package or the documents in the site package which was submitted to the board, which would include Verizon Wireless letter of intent, the hearing PowerPoint presentation, the radio frequency analysis, the National Environmental Policy Act report, the NEPA report, the FAA approval letter, the MAA approval letter, the Rhone Tower Structural and Foundation Design PE sealed report, and the site plan. And I've got one variation on that from Mr. Mudd.
First. Yes, I have.
All right. And do you adopt in the factual representations contained in each of those documents that are previous that I just identified from the board?
Yes, I do.
Same request with for Mr. Fisher.
Yes.
All right. And Mr. Mudd, in addition to you may not have reviewed all those documents. Could you identify for the board specifically the ones that you did not review?
I have copies of all of them, and I did look through them.
And in addition, you prepared a letter dated, I believe this is in the staff report, dated May 2nd, 2016, in which you outlined
the items or the manner in which the application complies with the St. Mary's County zoning ordinance, is that correct?
That's correct.
All right, and do you adopt the factual representations made in that May 2nd, 2016 letter as your testimony here this evening?
I do.
With that, Mr. Mudd, in your capacity as a professional engineer, do you have any opinion as to whether or not this application has met all the standards contained in the St. Mary's County zoning?
I believe that it does, yes.
All right. With that, I would proffer this, and we've got some documents for you, which are supplements to that. One of the comments made in the technical review committee's report was a concern raised by a county employee with respect to the AnagPres easement. And there were two concerns identified. One was that the access easement to the site was on AgPres property, and the other one was a concern about the fall radius. With respect to the first one, which was the access point, we moved it off the property that the owners had subjected to the conservation easement, so we addressed that one. With respect to the second, I think it arises in parts from some confusion about a fall zone and whether or not that easement is going to be, their easement rights are going to be impacted by it. And I believe it's also based on somewhat of an expansive reading of the terms of the easement document itself. The easement, that easement does not apply to the property in question. It's just, it's got to be, as you know, the tower's got to be a certain height away from the property line. The applicant owns both properties. It just so happens that on the other side of the line, he has subjected it to an agricultural use easement. We don't believe that putting a tower or him waiving that setback requirement with respect to two parcels of property implicates that easement. Notwithstanding that, what we did, and Mr. Mudd can follow up on this, and I believe it's already in your report from staff. The staff member who raised the issue requested some confirmation. But it's in the Roan report, and it's a stamp letter from the engineer which indicates that the tower has been designed, as you have heard in prior cases, to effectively break in the middle. The staff, Mr. Mudd, had a conversation with that staff person today who said, I need proof from the structural engineer that it will fall all on the lot in question. That letter does that. I don't think the staff person realized that she had it. So with that, I believe that removed the second concern which was raised in the technical review committee report, and Mr. Mudd can follow up with that, follow up on his recent conversation with the staff person today.
Mr. Smalley, are you familiar with what Mr. Wyro is speaking of as far as the easement on the second parcel?
Not till I'm listening to this discussion. My understanding is you got two parcels and you've got an easement for the fall. And did you indicate?
No, I'm sorry. I've got two parcels. One is where the tower is going to go. The second parcel, owned by the same property owners, subjected that property to an agricultural use easement.
Do you have it on slide?
Yep.
There we go. Can we see that?
And is that the only issue, that the tower, if it fell all the way, would fall
onto a property that has an agricultural use?
I don't think that's material.
Yeah, and rather than argue about it and take it up and say, give us an opinion, we said, okay, if we design the tower such that it falls, can only fall on this property, does that satisfy your concern? And with that, Mr. Mudd can tell you what the response was.
Right. The staff person said that all she needed was a letter from the structural engineer that said that the fall radius of the tower would be confined to the property that didn't have the easement, which is what this letter from our own engineering states. And I forwarded her a copy of it again this afternoon. And
I don't think it makes any difference.
Well, that was my first position, but I didn't want to get into that debate because it's easier just to design it the way that we did.
We don't like debates.
With that, so that was the only area in the technical review committee report that we thought would raise a concern. I'd also identify or indicate to you that in addition to the plantings that the statute requires around the enclosure, that we intend to put the two rows of plantings as the statute requires, and also a white fence, which we have previously done, because although the site is partially blocked by rows of trees, it's not completely, and we just thought we'd add this additional feature to it to spruce it up. So with that.
Paint that question.
You know, we keep going over this, about this fall radius, and it's a big deal, apparently. Okay, what about acceptance testing? Do y'all do that, or is this just a theoretical argument?
Sure, I can answer that. So the one of the oldest cell tower manufacturers in the country and the world is Rhone. And every single tower that has been built in St. Mary's County that's been built by us has been supplied by Rhone in Peoria, Illinois. And a monopole, just to give you an idea, a monopole is more expensive to build, obviously, than a guide tower, more expensive to build than a self-supporting tower, because the foundation is so enormous. The monopole is also the cheapest tower to insure, because they just don't fail that often. They need to have a direct hit of kind of a tornado in order to fail. Guide towers fail all the time. They're also the most expensive towers to insure, because all you need to do is to hit one of the guys, the tower comes down, and it's not necessarily certain where the tower is going to go.
Okay, so it's not one of these hasn't been constructed in a wind tunnel type force applied to it to see what the See if the engineering is what they claim it is.
Yeah, it has to be tested. I mean, Rhone.
Okay, that's what I asked.
It's sealed and certified by Rhone. I was just giving you the history. It's sealed and certified by Rhone so that monopoles, first of all, when they fail, they don't fall down straight down. They bend. So the pole doesn't ever actually hit the ground.
But you
can also design it through Rhone to bend in a lot of different areas depending on its failure, and that matters when it comes to setbacks. It's very important. Just so you know, it is significantly more expensive to have it collapse entirely within itself so that there's no footprint outside of and that it never touches the ground. Having said that, you still have antennas on that tower, and if it fails, some of those antennas, if it fails like that, it's likely some of those antennas are going to fall as well.
If you take the Rhone report, and if you're inclined, at pages H1, K1, K2, K3, K5, and then on into the next exhibit, which is KL, they go through a structural analysis at each elevation as you go up the tower and assume certain forces on it, and given the design of the tower, they can tell you what point along the tower is the weakest and under what conditions it's going to break at that point. So they do a very detailed structural
analysis. I understand that part. Right. I'm just asking, my initial question was acceptance testing, where this theoretical argument has been proven to be fact. I mean, when they build an airplane, believe me, it's a lot of acceptance
testing. Sure. No, it's a great question. Knowing engineers the way I do after doing this for 25 years, an engineer will not put their signature and a seal on any drawing that isn't the case, because they can lose their license. So, and this is a
company. That's if they have a license, I know 10,000 of them that don't.
So I'll represent to you, sir, that Rhone, go online and look at them. I'm not going to argue over this because it's a matter of fact. Go online, check Rhone out, and I'm sure you'll be happy with what you find. It's a company full of engineers that have been doing this for a very, very long time, highly respected, including for the utilities, by the way. It's not, we're not just talking about cell towers for telecommunications companies, but also for SMACO and for Pepco and for BG&E. How often do those poles fall?
Don't know. I mean, do you have statistics on that too?
I don't have that. But, you know, I'd say go online, check that out. I'm happy to provide it to you as well, if you want Ron to provide that to you. So.
Yeah, go right ahead. Thank you.
Any other questions? Mr. Wyrick?
I've got nothing else.
One question. Do we know, is Verizon going to be a voice or is it going to be a data tower?
Manish, that's your Manish question.
It will be a voice and data site. Okay. Sometimes get off the feet quickly. They deploy a data site, but ultimately they're all intended for voice and data.
Are you making a presentation this evening or not?
Are we making a presentation?
I don't think, unless you want to see the presentation again, we've adopted the facts. I think we've been through it enough with the board up. I'm happy to go ahead and do it if you want to hear it. But that's why I asked them those questions at the beginning.
Need it?
No, I don't need it.
I'm good.
I will, however, leave you with the disc.
Okay. That's the disc of your presentation.
That'll be it.
Okay.
Yeah. And hard copies.
Exhibit 3. Great. Any other questions here? Any other comments from you?
No, you're. Thank you.
Then I'm open for a motion.
Well, I can't.
We'll start. Let me open the public testimony first, just to make sure.
I don't have any shit.
Is this it?
Seeing none, we'll close public testimony. And any other discussion? Seeing none, I'm open for a motion.
Now I know why he gave me this one. In the matter of CUAP 15-135-008, Brown and Williams property, commercial communication tower, having made a finding that the standards for granting a conditional use and the objectives of section 51.3.91 of the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance have been met, I move to approve the request to build a monopole-style commercial communication tower at a height of 195 feet above ground level, subject to the following conditions. Number one, the tower shall be constructed so as to provide adequate capacity for future co-location of other commercial and or government-operated antennae. The system design plans shall delineate areas near the base of the tower to be used for the placement of additional equipment buildings for other users. Number two, no signals, lights, or illumination shall be permitted on the tower unless required by the Federal Communications Commission, the Federal Aviation Administration, or the county. Number three, no commercial advertising or other language shall be permitted on the tower. Number four, all obsolete or unused facilities, including buildings, towers, and all other improvements associated with the tower, shall automatically be deemed abandoned upon 24 months of continuous cessation of operations and shall be removed at such time without cost to the county. The applicant shall provide a bond, letter of credit, or other appropriate surety at time of approval as approved by the county to cover the cost for demolition of the facility and site restoration. Number five, contact information shall be prominently displayed on the fence enclosing each facility. This information shall be current and shall identify the company name, responsible individual, and phone number for the contact person. Number six, final site plan approval is required.
I have a motion.
Second.
Let's start with Mr. Green.
Oh, yes.
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 Yes. Okay. The board has voted unanimously to support your request this evening. An order reflecting the board's decision will be prepared by staff and signed by the board within 30 days. A 30-day period follows from the date the order is signed, during which any agreed party may appeal the board's decision and Circuit Court. Any action taken during that time will be at your own risk, and send your copy of the order once it's signed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. Our next order of business is the minutes. Anybody have an opportunity to take a look at the minutes? Any addition, deletions, corrections?
No.
No.
Just need a motion to sign, please.
I move that the minutes be approved and submitted.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We have two orders tonight. One of them is a variance request, VAAP 15-0790, the Birch property.
Which one was that?
The
house.
I believe that was the house.
There was a replacement house in the critical area buffer.
Okay.
Down off of Valley Lee, down off of Able Farm Way.
Right. Right.
Okay. And we had five members voting in the favor.
Make a motion to sign the order.
Have a Sorry. Motion. Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And the other order is the variance request, VAAP 14-132-009. That's the Morelli Order Group. And we approved that this evening. So I just, and
make a motion, we sign the order.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Any other business that we need to discuss or take care of? Then I'm open for a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Sir.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. I did.
Very good. Very good.